All right, we're back. Hit us up on Twitter if you want to join the discussion at the FF Dynasty. Let us know what's your fantasy. let's get back into these wide receivers.
Yeah, let's take it from a guy who the analytic community really
struggles with,
hates on because of the bad combine and all that other stuff.
If you have hate in your heart, let it out.
To a guy who the metric community absolutely loves, and after the combine, they certainly have as much of a hard-on, if not a harder hard-on.
Harder hard-on.
For this guy afterwards. And, you know, when somebody scores this well in the 97th percentile
of everything,
whatever the hell it is, you know, it's something that you definitely have to take notice to, especially when a guy...
Well, who are we talking about here?
DJ Moore.
DJ
if you haven't figured
Moore.
It out, we're talking about DJ Moore.
Which he prefers that you don't put the periods.
Doesn't like the dots.
On the D and the J.
Yeah, doesn't like the periods.
It's a DJ.
But he's a guy who absolutely blew up the combine.
So many blue numbers on the combine scores.
So many blue numbers, which means top performer.
Top performer.
And then when you get into the tape and what he did with Maryland and all that kind of stuff, he was, you know, kind of their whole offense and absolutely
college dominator is in the 97th percentile.
Right, and as we talked about Ridley, of, you know, how everybody was rolling coverage his way, everybody had to know that old DJ Moore was getting the ball, so he was seeing the toughest coverage on the field without a doubt.
Sure, and then he's seeing the second toughest opponents. His schedule is probably the second toughest
out of schedule. A lot of these guys we're going to talk about.
Right, he's going to get in that Big Ten.
He's in the Big Ten.
Solid, he had Wisconsin, Michigan State, Penn State,
Minnesota,
OSU,
then
yeah.
Out of conference is a UCF team.
Northwestern was pretty good this year.
Right, right. So, and a lot of those games, you know.
He did work. I mean, he set a school record with 80 receptions.
He did. He did do a lot of work, but let's take it back to game one and just go a little bit over how this season ended up, how it did with such piss poor quarterback play for old poor DJ Moore.
Played with four different QBs.
Right, so Week one, they go to Texas and beat up Texas with Tyrell Pigram. I'm pretty sure that's how you pronounce his name, but I'm not 100% sure.
It's not Tyrone Bigum.
So he goes out there, and when you watch the tape of that game, the passes are concise. They're right where they want to be. It's the offense is moving great. Maryland goes on the road, wins the game. DJ Moore looks awesome. Everything looks super fluid. I was loving what was going on there. So Maryland gets off to one of the better starts that they've had in a while. I think
beats a ranked Texas.
Beats a ranked Texas in Texas, and then they lose Pigram to an ACL injury here, which is no stranger to the Maryland franchise with quarterbacks. They've just had awful luck with quarterbacks for the last few years. But then freshman Kasim Hill comes in and he tears it up in the Townsend game, which, I mean,
it's Townsend,
but he tears it up and looks similar to what the first quarterback kind of game looks like. There's no indecision. It's decisive. He's getting the ball out quick to DJ Moore. DJ Moore looks super elite, and, you know, everything's going well for Maryland. And then early on in the next game, the UCF game, Hill tears his ACL, which is another huge bummer. And the wheels kind of fall off of Maryland as a team. And, you know, DJ Moore, like you said, still school record with 80 receptions and just had awful quarterback play.
Right.
So that's
it's pretty impressive.
Right. It's very impressive.
It's impressive to watch him play. I mean, he's another versatile guy. He lines up all over the field. They put him in the slot. He can go on the left or right side of the formation. He's got no fear. He'll go over the middle. He'll snatch that ball, take a big hit. I also think he's pretty good at avoiding a big hit.
Right.
He can diagnose it quickly.
Solid trait.
You can't really track it, but I like guys who are good at getting tackled.
Right.
Because some guys aren't good at getting tackled. It just looks awkward. Like every time Keenan Allen gets tackled, I'm like holding my breath.
I think there's a difference between being good or bad at getting tackled, because I don't think that's a real thing. But
no,
I think
it's totally a real thing.
I think it is a real thing to not get not take the big shots.
Right.
And I think that could be, you know, something guys are better at than other guys.
Sure, maybe. I still think you can be good at getting tackled. But I mean, another thing I really love about this guy is that he crushes it near the end zone. They threw him a lot of fades in the end zone, and I mean, a fade route in the end zone, that's like the easiest way to get 6 points, right?
Absolutely.
Well, I mean, I guess seven, because we're all playing PPR, right?
Who isn't?
I mean, if you're not,
you are.
really getting some use out of this.
Loving that new sound right there.
Try to get a new soundbite every week for you.
He's very aggressive in the red zone. He goes and gets it, even if it doesn't seem like it may be even a little bit out of bounds. There's multiple times where he's going and snatching it and still almost getting that toe inbounds near the red area, which is awesome.
And the balls aren't as accurate, with these other quarterbacks.
Bolin Schlager or whatever the hell. The four-string quarterback's name was.
So that's one of the negative things that I have about this guy is that, you know, you can see him visibly getting frustrated out there. You can see him sometimes taking a playoff. Off, but never near the red zone. Like, he's ready to go.
And I think, you know, I'll come back with that of saying, like, they're playing decent teams. They're getting blown out for the most part.
Right.
And he's seeing a lot of coverage, and he's not getting good balls thrown his way, and he's probably open sometimes, and the quarterback doesn't know what's going on and can't escape the rush or doesn't read the play right or all those kind of things. So, it's easy to get frustrated in that. You don't like to see it, but I can understand it.
Right. Yeah, I mean, this dude he's the quick twitch athlete. Like, he's got that quick twitch, and you see it in the combine numbers, and it shows up on the field. He's so explosive. He's a true threat to take it to the house from anywhere at any time. You love that.
And that can't be undervalued. Like, he's so strong and powerful, and then you couple that with the twitch quick kind of stuff.
Right.
And kind of built like a running back. He's, you know,
6'2", 210.
Right. Just
15 bench press reps, which is pretty solid. Right.
At one point they were saying that, you know, possibly he was maybe 220, 225 during the season. There were reports out there that he was that big, just being a big bodied, kind of looking like a running back out there.
Yeah.
So I thought that was interesting.
And that all leads to him being great after the catch. That's another awesome attribute. They threw him a lot of screens. He's so slippery on the one hand, but he's also powerful. He's just so lethal after the catch. He uses his blocks well. He's got a good feel for navigating through traffic and using those blockers. It's just fun to watch because, you know, like I said, he can take it to the house.
For sure.
If you give him a little crease.
Absolutely.
And then he returned kicks in 2016. He returned punts in 2017. So he's got that experience that's probably going to help him get onto an NFL field. So I think this guy has a decent chance. It's showing you some good stuff in his rookie year.
You got to like a strong, explosive guy who can get out there and return kicks and punts for a team, especially as a younger guy getting on the field. That's always a huge plus.
Another huge plus of him getting on the field is his ability to win in versus press man coverage. Like, he had great success.
I like you.
Right. We talked about how he's got this strong upper body. Like, good luck jamming this dude at the line of scrimmage. Yeah. He's got that quick twitchness combined with the start and stop explosive ability. It's just impossible to get your hands on him. If you do, he can fight you off. If you don't get your hands on him, he can juke you any which way to get around you. He didn't have any trouble with the press man coverage, and that's just another factor that's going to help him get onto the field.
Absolutely. I knew this has always been, and for a while, old Matt Kelly has been touting this guy as his guy, and, you know, really sticking to that. And then he blew the combine up. So after that happened, I went.
He's got 97th percentile in every category that sometimes matters.
I wanted to go on YouTube and just listen to a couple of the clips of kind of what he was saying about him, and I stumbled across a clip of him and Marcus Mosher talking about, you know, how maybe he'll be handled at the next level. And they were talking about maybe he would start off in the slot, and then, you know, maybe as next year goes on and he learns and grows and develops, maybe move him outside and then be a little more versatile and able to move around. And I thought that was a really good point. I think this is a guy who, we'll get into it in a little bit, but the route running isn't my favorite with this guy.
Yeah.
But if you can put him in the slot and get the ball in his hands, as we mentioned, he's so strong and powerful and quick. I think that's a good way to get explosive plays out of him, because he's kind of like a running back once he gets the ball in his hands.
Right.
And I really like that idea of
and
maybe
you can take your shots with him too out of the slot.
Exactly. You can still go up vertical with him and he'll get open.
Right.
So I kind of like that idea or theory on DJ Moore, and I know that's his boy and has been, so good for him.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you mentioned it, the route running. You know, it wasn't the best.
Yeah.
There's definitely a decent list of negatives with this guy. Route running being at the top of that, it seemed like there were rounded angles kind of at the top of the route. He didn't always take the most precise cut. It seemed like he was cutting corners almost, but not in a good way.
Right.
He just sometimes it's ridiculous how he looks with his moves and his changes of directions. But maybe he relies a little bit too much on that athleticism.
Sure.
If he'd hone in the route running and use that quick twitch change of direction, you know, ability that he has with him, he'd be unstoppable. But he just hasn't quite put it all together.
I think that's kind of where you're hoping that it will head. But
that's where the potential is right here.
And then you couple that with the athletic ability, and it's off the charts. You know, again, I
get why he's so high on people's boards because of this, the potential and the profile.
Right. And that going back to the slot thing, and that this is kind of why I don't disagree why he's one of the upper end guys, if not the top guy. I don't know if he's my top guy or not, but I think he is a guy, especially if a team did pick him up and maybe throw him in the slot, that he could be a guy and come out there and immediately produce for your fantasy team and give you good points. And like we've said multiple times, he can take it to the house. You just have to get the ball in his hands, you know, go to the house at any point. And I think coming from the slot is the best chance year one for him to get his legs under him and learn and develop and all that kind of stuff. But
yeah, I definitely don't hate that idea. At all. Another thing, another negative here is that he's dealt with some drops, which a lot of these guys have the occasional lapse and have their drops. But I definitely don't think any
of these guys are Larry Fitzgerald, logging like one college drop.
That's true. Nobody's old Fitzy. But I don't love this dude in the contested catch arena. Sometimes he doesn't even go up and make a play on the ball. Now I understand that he dealt with this bad quarterback play, and then they were getting blown out in a fair amount of games. But, you know, you got to still put it out. You got to put that effort forth the whole time. And sometimes he's just taking plays off, and, like, you got to go up and try to catch the ball. If I see you not even trying, it's like, man, come on, man.
Yeah, I mean, I don't love that either, but I will go back to what we kind of touched on earlier about how, you know, getting beat up,
right?
Tough game, bad quarterback, kind of stuff. But you do see sometimes where he's awesome in the contested catch arena. So
yeah, he can definitely make a wild play. I mean, he's an electric guy that can take it to the house from anywhere. He's got tons of potential. He's got a great smile.
Right.
He looks like a star. He looks like he can step into that role and handle that from a you know, being a star wide receiver in the NFL. I don't think he's going to be on any of my teams. I think that he's going to go too high in a rookie draft for me.
Right.
I think he's going to go probably top six, and I don't think I'm going to take any wide receivers that high. I would probably pass on him that high and then try and take some of these other wide receivers we're going to talk about a little bit later and towards the second round. You know, your Anthony Millers, the Gallups. I think I'd rather take the stab on the running back that high. I doubt he's going to fall to the back end of a first round draft. So I don't see him being on my team.
Well, what you're drafting more for is, again, I think you can get maybe some early stuff out of him off the rip, and some year one points for your team.
But
then you're drafting that potential ceiling
of
ridiculousness.
He's,
sure.
His
and
name
that.
Is worth drafting alone. Like, you know that he's probably not going to lose too much value even if he doesn't do anything year one because of his profile and how everybody loves him and the hype. But if he does happen to show you something, then that value is just going to even go up even further. So maybe it's not a bad swing to take because his name has safeness written on it.
Right. And with the display that he put up in the combine and that kind of stuff, and then the production on the field where, you know, he's the whole team basically.
Right, going against good defense with a back quarterback.
You got to love the potential, and you know, the ceiling is pretty limitless on this guy right now, and I think that's what intrigues a lot of people to take him as the one overall.
Right. Yeah, and I can't, you know, I can't argue too much
as
the with you.
One receiver overall.
Right. Yeah. Obviously.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that'll put a bow on DJ Moore. Let's go ahead and take another break, and we'll be back with more Married to the Game.